When people are coming to live in North America, they almost always have a difficult time, especially Orthodox people, because the culture of North America is so different from Orthodox cultures. It is, you could say, like going to the moon, perhaps, or maybe Mars. It is so different. At least it is in some ways. The worldview of North America is certainly very different, and especially because it is Western. So I'm going to talk a little bit about this and these difficulties, and talk about survival a little bit, if these words mean anything. It is true that in all the Orthodox countries except Greece, yes, except for Greece, in the East, there was a period when everybody was suffering from communism. And during the time of communism, there was definitely a Western and very materialistic mentality injected into our Orthodox societies. But the society was only infected a little bit, and especially in Romania, of course, because Romania, of all the countries, remained the most faithful. I still remember when I was younger, back about 1975 or so, because I'm getting old, I can't remember for sure when this was. But it was along about those years. I remember hearing that in those days, Romania retained about 85% of its population as Orthodox faithful, practicing somehow Christian, which was always amazing to me. When we compare that with what happened in Russia or Ukraine, it's a very big contrast, because the population of believers in those countries was cut very severely. And I suppose that if we're going to be seriously estimating the numbers of believers, it might have been as much as, well, I mean, practicing believers, it might have been as much as 10% at the most of the whole population in those days. And even at that, maybe I'm being too generous. Well, I don't have to rehearse this history for you because you wrote very well. But I do want to point out that among those who, especially among those who have remained as believers, being an Orthodox Christian makes us have a particular attitude towards the world that is different from that of the West. In the West, the world, the creation around us, is generally considered to be a bunch of objects which are for our employment. We can use everything. And this is this attitude is based on how they understand God's command to Adam and Eve at creation, that they should go and subdue all of creation. Well, the Orthodox people don't understand the beginning of creation quite so violently as that. The whole Orthodox mentality towards creation is respect for God, what God has created, what God has made, and we understand that He has put us here amongst creation to work together with Him in this creation to make it yet more beautiful, yet more ordered, and, well, the way He wants it to be. However, if we look at it from the Western and materialistic perspective, when all these things are just for us to use and to make whatever we want of them, and even worse, when we are making whatever we want of these things without any reference to God at all, the result is the poisoning of our environment, the killing of our environment in which we are presently living, and from which we are, the whole of the world, suffering. The West mentality is linear. It's like men, the way men think. Linear, in a straight line. Women always understand that about men. The Orthodox way of perceiving the world is holistic, it's spherical. And that's actually the way women think. It's everything all together. It's not one thing after another. It's all everything all together. Now, because there are men who are Orthodox, not all Orthodox men are so linear thinkers. They're not completely limited to linear thinking. But the characteristic of men and women is basically like this anyway. If we are perceiving creation as a whole, as we ought to be, if we are Orthodox Christians, then we understand that everything that we do and everything that we say affects everything else in creation. What I do for good or what I do for bad affects everybody and everything else. And that's why, for instance, in Seraphim of Sarov will have said, St. Seraphim of Sarov said that if you save your soul, thousands will be saved with you. But if you lose yourself, the same applies, because when you lose yourself, you create some sort of black hole into which you drag other people with you. So, either way, for good or for bad, we are affecting everybody and everything around us. This is, I believe, how we Orthodox properly understand our life. So we have a big responsibility, we Orthodox. We have a big responsibility because we, Orthodox, have inherited from those who have gone before us the whole truth about Him who is the truth. And that is, of course, Jesus Christ. Here's another contrast between the Orthodox mentality and the Western mentality. The Western philosophical mentality understands that there are many truths, which I have always found a logical impossibility. But people insist that I'm a dinosaur, and I guess I am. But how can it logically be that there is more than one truth? Truth has to, there has to be an end to this truth. Even according to the Augustinian, Aristotelian logic that St. Thomas Aquinas of the West used, he understood that it was properly understood that there has to be an ultimate good, there has to be an ultimate truth, and this has to end in Jesus Christ. But the West forgot all about this particular part of the logic, because the West is forgetting all about God, because we have made ourselves into God ourselves. And this is our curse, I suppose. Getting back to our responsibility, there is one truth, and this truth, Jesus Christ, is for whom we live and for whom we witness. We have the responsibility, as the gospel has given us from the words of the Savior himself, we are to be the Orthodox, wherever we are in the world, we are supposed to be yeast and salt. In other words, we are supposed to be giving flavor to the society in which we live. And the society in which we live is mostly tasteless. So we can do something for it. And we can give life to the society in which we live, because that's what yeast does. It gives life. And we can give life because we have Christ, who is the giver of life. So we are sharing Christ and the life he gives to us and with everybody else. And we share this life with everyone else. And it's good, because in our society, people are becoming mechanical creatures, living from day to day, getting up in the morning, getting to work, making money, coming home, taking children to everything under the sun if they have time, falling asleep, very tired, get up in the next morning, doing the same thing over and over and over again. On Saturday, people are working and working and working to do all the things that they have no time to do from Monday to Friday. On Sunday, lots of them don't even bother to go to church because they're too tired and they sleep in. And then they start to have heart attacks because their body rhythm is a wreck. We Orthodox Christians can, by remembering who we are, what our life is in Christ, we can help people to find a better way to live in Christ that is not driven just to make by just making money, by just becoming comfortable in this world, but by understanding that if we are faithful and if we are following Christ and living in his love, then he provides for us everything that we need. Maybe we won't be millionaires, but we don't necessarily need to be millionaires. We need to be living alive, strong, joyful, powerful human beings who can share Christ's love and who can share Christ's life. The last thing I want to say, second last thing, here's one more thing. Second last thing I want to say is that the foundation of our Orthodox way is and always has been love. It's from the beginning of my life that I learned this, and this is one of the advantages of having begun my life as a Lutheran, because I was taught in the beginning a lot about the scriptures. And I had to memorize. In those days you had to memorize, not now, but then I had to memorize all sorts of portions of scripture. And those things from my childhood remain here to this day, and they come from time to time when I need them. And I still remember the very nice old people. I thought they were old then because I was 5. These old people were saying these verses themselves, and I can still remember them saying these verses themselves. And they were actually God-loving persons, too. So, and the main thing is, I'm trying to say, from this I remember the words of the Apostle John. We love God because he first loved us. So God loves us, and we therefore love him. And if we look at the Ten Commandments in Deuteronomy, the fifth book of Moses, and look at the introduction to those Ten Commandments, what do we see? We see these words from Moses. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength. Loving God is the foundation of everything. It always has been. God created us in the first place because he loves. We are the product of his love. Our existence is maintained by his love. And when we come to the end of our lives, we will be protected and embraced in His love in the kingdom. This is what our life is about. It is about a relationship of love with God, with each other, and with creation. So that's the second last thing. The very last thing I want to say is that in this particular parish, where we have patrons Constantine and Helen, you have very good examples of how to live in a difficult environment. Because, in the first place, Constantine was the object of an attempt to murder. People tried to kill him, in other words. And yet, being a warrior and a general, and somehow having an open heart, he understood when the Lord showed him the sign in which he would conquer. And he came to understand that this was Jesus Christ himself in whom he would conquer. He began to change everything in his life. He did conquer. But not only did he conquer armies, he also conquered evil in Christ, in his life. And he brought new life to the whole Roman Empire. Just a few weeks ago, I had the blessing to be in the Holy Land. And in the Holy Land, you cannot go anywhere without seeing and hearing about the work of the Empress Helen, the mother of Constantine. What a strong woman is Helen. And it's important for you to remember that even though people will want to say that in the Roman Empire women were nothing and they couldn't do anything, okay, what about Helen? What about Helen? And she was far from alone. In other words, what I'm saying is that if people think that in the Roman Empire women couldn't do or have anything, they are completely asleep and they are not reading history. Because women could, in the Roman Empire, hold property. They could have businesses. They could inherit, bequeath, they could do all sorts of things. So Helen was not alone, but she was still uniquely strong and unique in her contribution to us, because she went herself to Palestine and she understood there the importance of the oral tradition. In North America, people say, oral tradition? What's that? People can't remember anything for 5 minutes. Well, that's because in North America, we're falling apart. But in a society such as that, or in these Aboriginal societies in Alaska or other places, people have an oral tradition which is very particular and very well kept and very, very accurate. Their inherited stories about where things were and what happened are memorized, and they are carefully watched by those who are teaching. They make the receivers repeat and repeat and repeat until it's correct. When it's correct, then they keep checking to make sure. And there are other people around also hearing the same inherited stories, and they are checking also. And so it is that when Helen went to the Middle East, to Palestine, and to Jerusalem, and to Bethlehem, and to other places in the Galilee and in the Jordan Valley, she encountered Christians who had remained in this area from the time of Christ. They had not left. They had been hiding from the Romans, but they had not gone away. And they kept going to the holy places. And even in the city of Jerusalem, they kept going to the holy places. They knew still, even though Jerusalem was leveled by the Roman army twice, they still knew exactly where it was that the cross was buried. I mean, where it was hidden in the ground. They remembered where was the spot of Golgotha, and they remembered where was the place of the tomb of Christ. And they led Helen to these places. They led her also to Bethlehem, to the place of the cave where Christ was born. All these things people remember. You remember, by the way, that in the Gospel, it is said about the Mother of God that she kept these things in her heart, all these details in her heart. She did not just keep them for herself. She was sharing these events and these details with the apostles also. That's how we know about them. She shared. We know that she kept them in her heart, yes, but she didn't keep them locked there. She shared from that well of light in her heart. And the fruit of that was, in the first place, the opening of all these holy places by Helen when she went to Palestine. But she didn't stop there, because together with her son, they applied all sorts of money to the building of temples to the Lord on these places. And we still have parts of these, even parts of the constructions of Helen in the 4th century. We still have remnants of these constructions of her. We still can go, at least at the time being, we still can go to these holy places and walk where the Lord walked and be in the places where these important events occurred. Not that everybody must, but when it is possible, it is a blessing. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. His love does not change. His love is with us the same way as his love is with the apostles and with all the saints who have been even before the incarnation and after. Jesus Christ remains the same. And his love is the same. He said he is with us until the close of the age, and he alone is faithful. And to him be glory, together with his Father, whose name everlasting, is all holy, with the life-giving Spirit, now and ever, and unto the ages of ages.
The first question is related to what you said in the short introduction that you made to us. Yeah, you said that everything that we do, whether it's good or bad, it's a fact of the creation.
Yes.
And I would like if you can develop a little bit on this. And the second question is, it happened that last year I read a small book in Romania about the cross that was discovered by Helen, and it was a historical trace back of the cross to the history and back to Adam had actually. And I was wondering if you have any of those historical short detail, if you can find them.
This is not such short details. The first question again, because I...
The first question was...
How things are affected.
Yes.
Everything, it's relatively simple. I can't develop it too well, but there are two things I'll say. We human beings are all interconnected with all other human beings. Genetically, yes, but spiritually also, in a way that we often don't pay attention to. But we are connected to each other. You can sometimes notice when you're in the presence of someone else, you might feel unfamiliar emotions. You might, for no reason, feel edgy, or you might feel angry, or you might feel fearful, or something of that sort. And if you don't know why you feel this way, because there's nothing making you feel like this in your life at this moment. But in fact, it's because this other person is feeling whatever it is that you're feeling, and you, especially as a sensitive person, an Orthodox person, should be sensitive. So as a sensitive person, being near such a person, you're feeling the pain or the suffering of this other person, or the struggle of this other person. So that's just an example of what I mean. So, you know, people are making a lot about this sometimes, about these scientific ideas that the flapping of the wings of some butterfly in a forest in China is going to affect the weather of North America sooner or later. You may have heard of this. So, and it, to some extent, maybe that's the case, but it's an extreme sort of example of that kind of influence. But if we are doing good and living good, shall I say, then the Lord is multiplying this good. I've heard it said that more than one time that probably the world is still has not come to its end because of the faithful prayer of maybe half a dozen or a dozen people in the world who are so full of God's love, and they are interceding so powerfully with the Lord for the world that things still continue. And I have seen over and over and over again how when people are praying for each other and asking God for his mercy for each other, the Lord's love is being poured out. And people are wonderfully healed, or they're delivered from slavery to demons, and all sorts of things are happening because people are praying. So that's sort of what I mean. Is that short enough? Okay. So if you're doing what you should be doing in a good way, it does affect other people very well. But if you are falling and turning your back on God and being negative, it will drag people down also. There's this tendency to drag people down. Just because when you're I gave this example of how you can feel the negativity of another person. If you don't know yourself and realize that this negativity is not you and from you, you can identify somehow this negativity as yours. You can say, "Oh, I feel horrible. I feel edgy. I have no idea why, but I guess that's me." And then you embrace this negativity, and then you accept a lie about yourself and think it's you. And then you start living like that and turn your back on the Lord and forgetting. You go down and down. So, knowing who you are in the Lord, in the context of his love, is really important.
How about people who don't believe in the church, but they still do good? About the people that...
Well, this is...
Is there something to be said about
them? Yes, there is something to be said about them. Something good to be said about them. Because the Apostle Paul says to us that we can only determine and make judgments about ourselves in the church. We can talk about ourselves and our life together in the church. It's the Lord who looks after people who are outside. So if there is good in people outside, and there is much good still in people who are outside the church, this is not separated from God. Because you cannot do and be good without him somehow. Even if you don't recognize him, this good that is from him is still somehow making a connection with him.
So a person who is Indian or Japanese or never learned about Christ, but he still listens to his conscience and he's doing well, can...
This is to his credit. And it's good, it reflects God somehow. We can't say any more than that, because we don't know what happens between him and God. What we do know is that Christ is the way. And that's all we can say. We don't know.
Do you want to find out if he's going to find eternal life?
Do you think we can make him?
We can hope that, that such a person might, but it's still that's how the Lord is would give this. We don't know. Missionaries in Alaska and other places in the past, and in the present also in Africa and other places, generally will encounter a non-Orthodox culture, and they will see what is good in this culture and what is in harmony with the Orthodox way. And they speak to the people about this. They talk about the things that are good in their culture, in their lives, in their personal ways.
So is it okay for an Orthodox person to encourage whatever a person is, like Japanese?
Yes.
Is it okay to encourage him doing good in his Buddhism ways,
Of course it is.
And
yes.
Without, persuade him to become an Orthodox if he doesn't want to or if he doesn't think.
The best way to help that person become Orthodox is to show your love. You see, a Buddhist has a difficulty, because a Buddhist is just a follower of a philosophy. It's not a religion, even though people talk about it as a religion. Buddhism is just a philosophy, and there's no God in it at all. They have no God at all. So there's no personal relationship with anybody or anything, and this is what they are missing. So what there is good coming from their philosophy is okay, it's good, that is good. But the personal connection with living God is what we can give and share. So by your personal example, you can help this person to understand that there is more than just the Buddhist philosophy. The Buddhist philosophy can be fulfilled in Christ. But that means you have to understand a little bit about Buddhism in order to help to talk to this person.
It's too overwhelming to learn about each religion.
So the most important thing then is to be an authentic, God-loving, Christ-loving, Orthodox Christian and a good example. And the other thing to do is to pray for this person. I'll give you an example. I know one person who had seen a young man growing up from infancy, a neighbor. And she saw how in his the beginning of his teen life, he was going away from believing in anything. And he was just becoming a plain secularist. So she decided, because she cared about this young fellow, that whole family had been close to her, she started to pray for him. So every day, she offered this young man's name before the Lord. Every day. And then they would be walking their dogs in the park nearby and talking from time to time. After 8 years of this, this young man said to her, "What is it about God? What is it about Christ?" So they started talking. Now he's a deacon in our church. So this is what I'm saying. You can be and pray and wait patiently and encourage the good that you see in the other person and be an example, first of how good you can be as an Orthodox Christian, but also how you can admit you could make mistakes and say you're sorry, which people don't like to do. And this will also help.